Hello to everybody out there at River Point and West End. We're so glad you're here today. I want to remind you of a very important date coming up. It's Palm Sunday. It's really one of the most special days in our ministry calendar because it's the day we celebrate with baptism. Now, baptism here at our church is a little different. It's a what we call a believer's baptism. This is a baptism that you decide to have for yourself. I know many of you were baptized as an infant, and that means your parents made that decision. It was a great church tradition. This is different. I want you to take a step forward today. I want you to move forward in your faith in Jesus Christ by publicly identifying with Him in baptism. That's all it is. It's a death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that's what you're identifying with. You can sign up in the lobby today at all three campuses. We want you to be baptized on Palm Sunday, which we're doing on all three campuses. Now, you're in for a special treat today because we've got a brand new friend with us. His name is Ryan Leek. This guy is a dynamic speaker. He's been on many talk shows for the different projects he's been on. You're gonna love what he has to say. He wrote a book called Chasing Failure, which is available at all campuses today. You can pick that up in the lobby. Pick up his book, but more importantly, make Ryan feel welcome. He might be a little nervous. He doesn't know who we are. Let's make him feel like family. Would you please welcome my friend, Ryan Leek?
What's going on? Well, hey, my name is Ryan. It is so awesome to be here. We're glad that you are in church. I want to say hello to the Missouri City campus, and also Inside the Loop, we want to say hey to the West End campus. There's a couple things that you need to know about me before we get started today. Number one, I'm married. I believe we have a picture of my wife that they're going to throw up on the screen. This is Amanda Roman Leek. Now, you said, wow, exactly. I know what you're thinking. First thing you're thinking is, how in the world did he get her? Let me tell you. About 6 years ago now, I overheard my wife tell her best friend, I think it'd be cool to get engaged and married on the same day. Now, I had no idea what that meant, so I guessed. So for 2 years, I planned what is called the surprise wedding behind her back. So on June 7, 2013, I get down on one knee and I say, baby, will you marry me? She said, yes. I said, just kidding. Will you marry me today? And we opened up this ballroom door, and about 100 of our family and friends were standing in there with the sign that said, today! And so we got married 8 hours later, and we rolled in the dress, we rolled in the makeup artist, hairstylist, everything you would need to get married and engaged on the same day. So we uploaded it to YouTube. It got about 1.5 million views. We did a whole bunch of talk shows, all that jazz. And so we got engaged and married on the same day, started having sex right away and had a baby. This is Jackson Carter Leek. He is a future first round draft pick in the NBA. So write his name down, Jackson Carter Leek. Remember him. And that's sort of our story. We've had a wonderful opportunity to travel around the country just sharing our story and what God has been able to do in our life. Today isn't about me. Today is actually all about you. And it's all about the dreams that perhaps God has put on the inside of you. Whether you're a Christian today or maybe you're just a person that's just visiting and it's your first time, that's awesome because it's my first time too. So if you don't like the message, come back next week. I'm sure it'll be great. But I want to look at a verse that I believe is going to encourage us to step towards the dreams God has called us to. And it's found in Joshua chapter 1. The Bible says this, be strong and courageous, for you shall cause this people to inherit the land I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to do according to all the law that Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may have good success wherever you go. Today, I want to talk to you about the subject of how to be brave. Father, in these next few moments, I pray that you would awaken something on the inside of us for the purpose and dreams that you've placed inside of us since we were born. I pray, Lord God, that we would courageously step towards those things. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Everybody say it. I love this time of the year because it's the part of the year where people have their New Year's resolutions and they are slowly starting to fade. You know, people say, hey, I'm going to eat healthier. And they had one salad one day and they felt like that wiped away all their sins in their whole life. It's the time of the year where the gym is taking money out of your bank account every single month, but they never see you. Or when they do see you, this is so funny. I had a friend, she came over the other day. She was hanging out with me and my wife, and she said, hey, I'm coming from the gym. We were like, okay, we're expecting a person to look like they were coming from the gym. And she walks into our home, and her face is, well, perfect. The makeup, nothing has changed. And we said, hey, didn't you say you were at the gym? She said, I was. I said, did you do your makeup on the way from the gym to our house? She said, no, I just went to the gym. I said, did you work out? She goes, well, no. I'm like, you know, that's the point, right? She goes, I said I went to the gym. Nobody said I actually had to work out. And I was like, well, why didn't you work out? She said, it's just intimidating, okay? Like, there's this thing inside of us that's like, okay, I have a lofty goal of what I know what I want to do, but all of a sudden when I go to do it, and I get a little scared. It's like when you go to sign up for a gym membership, they give you the tour, and it's all great. You're like, man, this is awesome, all the spa. Oh, man, this is going to be great. Oh, look at the Stairmaster. And we envision ourselves on the Stairmaster until we get on the Stairmaster. And all of a sudden, our legs are burning. We can't feel our arms. And we're like, we don't like this. And then all of a sudden, you're lifting 20-pound dumbbells. And you see somebody that's lifting 40. And you're just like, I'm never going to be them. On some level or another, there is a gap between who we are and who we want to be. We are people that are full of lofty notions of, okay, tomorrow I'm going to be a better. And sometimes it goes even deeper than just New Year's resolutions. For some of us, it's, you know what? I'm really going to be a better dad this year. I'm really going to be a better husband. I'm going to start a business. I'm going to actually do the thing that I feel like God's been asking me to do that maybe he's birthed on the inside of me. And there's just this gap. There's this, we're so comfortable in complacency. We live in a culture where not dreaming is easier than having a big dream that can be torn down. It's easy to be a spectator in the crowd. It's easy to sit on the sidelines because you won't have to be critiqued and no one will have to poke holes at your dreams and no one will have to bring you back down to earth. It's so easier to do that, but it's so much harder to sleep when we do nothing. And in fact, this is what I believe. I believe the bridge between who we are and who we want to be is courage. It's courage. And in the Bible, we see God talking to a leader in the Bible, and he's telling him to be strong and to be courageous. And boy, did he need it. About a year and a half ago, I had a friend named Liz who, unfortunately, she passed away of stage 4 cancer. And she was 30 years old, marathon runner, very healthy. She's just gone too soon. Gone way too soon. And while it was very sad, we started to go to her memorial service in Dallas in this church, and it was standing room only. And while I thought it was going to be a sad occasion, it was actually one of a celebration of a life that really inspired me. You see, Liz was the type of person that always went the extra mile. You know your real friends on the day that you're moving. And here's why. You don't like moving your own stuff, let alone somebody else's stuff. And on the day that you're moving, your friends and your family come up with the craziest excuses they've ever had. They're like, oh, I got to take my kid to soccer. I'm like, your kid don't even play soccer. They enrolled him in soccer the day you move. I mean, it just always happens. And I was moving from one part of Dallas to another, and sure enough, I had 10 people sign up and only one person that said, hey, I'm still in, and it was Liz. Liz said, hey, I can help you move, but the only problem is I don't have a car. And she lives about 3 miles from me at the time, on the other side of downtown Dallas. And she said, you know, if I can get to your house, you know, we can figure it out. And I was in the moving truck, and I said, hey, if you can figure out a way to get to my place, that would be great, but no biggie if you can, I'll figure it out. And it was raining outside. And so what Liz did is actually she put on a raincoat and ran 3 miles through downtown. I got my keys and packed up half my stuff and put it in the car and drove it to my new place. I'm not talking about a person that I say she went the extra mile. She actually went extra 3 miles, literally. And I thought I was the only person that had an extra mile story about Lizzie. But when I got to her memorial service, everybody did. It was like we were trying to one-up each other with Liz stories. And it was this person that just was a carpe diem type of person. She gave everything she possibly had to every moment she had in life. And her husband, he got up to give a speech, and he called it 25 Things I Learned from My Wife, Lizzie. He spoke for an hour and 15 minutes. It was a beautiful a message that he put together, and it was awesome. He opened up the Bible, and in the Bible, there is this thing called the love chapter. And it basically talks about what true love really is. And it goes like this. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It goes on and on and on. And here's what he did. He read that verse and he goes, couldn't we substitute the word love for Liz? And then he read it out loud and he said, Liz is patient. Liz is kind. Liz does not envy. And there was just this feeling in the room where we all just went, yeah. That actually perfectly describes who Lizzie is, who Lizzie was. And it was funny, as we were leaving the memorial service, I heard some of our friends, they were like, you know what? One day I want somebody to be able to open up the Bible and substitute my name for positive words. And I said, then you're going to have to start being kind. You're going to start being patient. And in all reality, there is something on the inside of us that we want people to call us something that we actually aren't. We want people to say these great things about us, but sometimes it's so hard to put action towards it. And one of the things that her husband, Chris, he said, the first thing was that his wife taught him was to do crap. He was like, Liz just did crap all the time. And she just inspired me just to do stuff, like every single day to do it. And number two, not just to do crap, but do crap today. Because that we have so many great intentions for tomorrow. And I'll never forget, I walked out of that memorial service with this thought. Become today who you intend to be tomorrow. Become today who you intend to be tomorrow. Because there's this thought of, I'm going to be a better dad tomorrow. And on Monday, I'm going to go to the gym. And when I go to the gym, I'm actually going to work out when I get there. And I'm going to be a better. So on and so on. Later on. No, you won't. How long have we been telling ourselves that? It starts today. And what keeps us from living today who we want to be tomorrow is lots of questioning. We question ourselves on every level. We're going, man, do I have enough? Am I good enough? Why would I write a book? Because if I write a book, that means I have to have readers. And what if I only have 10 readers? For some of us, we're like, I don't want to go big unless it can be successful. So And then you look at the people who are very successful, and then you compare yourself to them, and then before you know it, you go, there's not a whole lot in me at all. And I got good news for you. Here's what the Bible says in Peter that I think is really going to encourage us. Let's go to the Peter verse. How about that? It's in like 2 slides. Great. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Here's what God's saying. I've already put it in you. There's something special already on the inside of you to be exactly who I've called you to be. And the question that you just saw that I really want everyone to answer is what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for to become today who you intend to be tomorrow? What is it? Is it a better circumstance? Is it more money? Is it more influence? Is it more Twitter followers? Is it a blog? What is it that you're waiting for to be exactly who God has called you to be and to do it? To write that book, to start that business, to be that dad? You tell me, what is it? And here's the deal. You're really smart. You can figure that out. It's easy. Here's a question you may never know the answer to. Not just what are you waiting on, but who's waiting on you? Who is waiting on you? Who is perhaps an unknown single mom who is waiting for you to put your story on pen and pad? Who is waiting on you? Is it a student that perhaps is addicted to drugs and perhaps you've never told anybody about your story of what you came from, and you go, my story doesn't matter, but your story could matter and could change a life. Who is waiting on you? As a part of the surprise wedding and our video going viral, me and my wife ended up going on the Queen Latifah show. And when we go on the Queen Latifah show, a producer comes in the back and they say, hey, here are the questions that the Queen's going to ask you, and it's three questions. So, you know, we go through the whole deal, we answer a few questions, and then Queen Latifah goes for a fourth question on national television. I'm like, whoa, what are we doing? And she says, Ryan, do you think Amanda could surprise you the same way that you surprised her? And in my mind, I'm thinking, I mean, what is she going to do? What, are we going to go to the moon? Like, I don't understand what the equivalent is. I'm like, sure, yes, why not? And so my wife says, hey, Ryan, me and the Queen have been working on a little surprise for you, so go ahead and check this out. Go ahead and look at the screen. So I go to look at the screen, and on the screen comes this guy by the name of Kobe Bryant. Kobe Bryant says, hey, Ryan. And when he said, hey, Ryan, I'm not positive that Queen Latifah's couch stayed dry, okay? lost my mind a little bit, and then I started breaking it down like it was scripture. I'm like, okay, he said, hey, Ryan, which means he knows my name. Somebody told him, like, how in the world does he know who I am? And he began to say, hey, you know, we want to invite you out to Staples Center and just come hang out with the Lakers. And I was just like, okay, bae, you win. Game's over, okay? You win. This is great. And so I actually had about 2 months to prepare to meet Kobe Bryant. Now, I hang out with a lot of different people, and I really don't get starstruck, but most of the people I hang out with aren't Hall of Famers. They've never scored 81 points. They're not MVPs. They don't have, like, five rings on their hand and stuff. Anyways, I started honestly freaking out. I started practicing my greeting in the shower for months. Hey, Kobe. No, that's too much. That's too much. Your voice is too deep. It's too much. It's too much. Hey, Kobe. Nope, too hot. Can't go that way. Can't do that. No, don't do that. Like, okay, you can't be a rookie fan and come with a jersey. Like, hey, will you sign my whole body? You can't do that. You got to be like, it's an honor for you to meet me, Kobe. Like, you're just going through all of these different things in your mind of like, okay, how is this going to work? Is he taller than me? Do I act like I'm ready to play him? Do I wear, like, basketball shorts? Do I wear jeans? You know, like, I can't wear a suit. That's too much. You're doing too much. And I'm just over-analyzing, overthinking it, because if I'm honest, I wanted to make an impression on somebody that made an impression on me. And I began to ask myself the question that I believe each and every one of us is faced with whenever we think about doing anything amazing. Am I good enough? Am I good enough? Is who I am impressive to anyone at all? And for me, it was, is Kobe going to be able to understand what I do for a living? And is it going to be enough for him to be engaged in a conversation? And so here's where I landed. Long story short, I landed on this. The only way Kobe's going to be interested in who I am or what I do is if I'm in the NBA. Yep. It was easy. I just went, hey, if I could just be in the NBA, problem is solved. Now, I know you might not be able to tell from either watching online or from the stage perception, but I'm 6'3", and I was an All-American in college, and so I'm pretty good at basketball. Now, pretty good at basketball is not enough to be NBA good at basketball. It is an astronomical difference, trust me. I found out the hard way, okay? So, but nevertheless, I thought, well, let me get in shape. Let me at least try. So I had this friend who actually got cut from Chicago Bulls, and we were in Dallas. We're playing one-on-one. And I'm like, man, you just got cut. He's like, yeah, man, it was tough. Now, I'm 6'3", 195. He's 6'6", 2:30. I'm like, I got this. We good. So we start playing one-on-one, and we play one-on-one about five times. He beat me every time by about five, okay? So there was a pretty clear distinction between me and him, and if they cut him, I'm going, I know exactly what they're going to do to me. And I realized that day in that gym that I was going to fail. I was like, there's no way I'm ever going to be in the NBA. It's not going to happen. And I remember sitting on a bleacher, and I remember thinking this thought, so what? Who cares? And really, how do we know that you're going to fail unless you try? And that day, a new project was birthed called Chasing Failure. And I had this thought. Every successful person you know has failed. Yet we all get into this line of chasing success. So I decided to start a line for failures and say, hey, I want to teach the world how to fail. I want to encourage every single person I know to just go for it and see what happens. So when I met Kobe Bryant, I said, hey, Kobe, my name's Ryan. I don't have anything for you to sign. I'm a filmmaker, and I'm making a film called Chasing Failure, and I want to encourage every single person in America to go for their dreams. And he goes, every kid in America needs to hear that message. I'm like, yeah, what you said, Kobe. Yeah, of course they do. That's why I'm making the documentary. Duh, that's why I'm here. Duh. And then I realized I forgot to tell him what I was going to fail. I was like, oh, man, he probably thinks I'm going to go bungee jumping. Like, oh, my God, what are we going to do? So I said, hey, I'm going to be in the NBA. And he says, yeah, do it. I go, you're not supposed to say that. You were supposed to laugh. You were supposed to say, good luck, kid. You don't know how hard it is. No, he just stone cold face looked at me and just said, do it. The only problem is this. Now that I've told people that I'm going to be in the NBA, I've also told Kobe Bryant, who at the time was actually in the NBA, that I was going to be in the NBA. I've told my family and friends this. It's not that I was lying. It's just that, they don't really let pastors and motivational speakers try out for basketball teams very often. That's not how it works. It's not the YMCA. It's the National Basketball Association. So you just kind of, I had to figure out a way to actually get an NBA tryout. And so I did the thing that we all do when we don't know what to do. I Googled it. And so I Googled the PR directors of every NBA team. There's a website that has all their emails. And so I just like, okay, I hop on the internet. Just started emailing them. And the Boston Celtics wrote back and they said, this is a really cool story, but it's not for us. And I went, did the Boston Celtics just email me? It's just different. You know, it's like, what did you do today? It's like, well, I was a little busy. So then the Clippers said, hey, it'll be $50,000 for a permit just to film. I said, bless you. Then I heard back from the Phoenix Suns, and the Phoenix Suns said, we really like this idea. Why don't you come on Monday? I said, like this Monday? You want me to come? I was kind of kidding. I didn't really think any... I literally thought I was going to make a documentary about me emailing 30 NBA teams being told no. And like, you guys are going to watch me just like get really discouraged at my laptop and be like, you can do it though, guys. Let's go for it. Like, that was the goal. And then one team said yes. I said, okay. They said, hey, bring your camera crew on Monday. And I went, camera crew? Yeah, we'll be there. Who are these people? We don't know them yet. So I grabbed a guy from the church, video guy, said, listen, it's a long story, but I need you to come to Phoenix with me. He's like, for what? I go, I know you're not going to believe me, but I'm trying out for the Phoenix Suns real fast. We just got to go and come back. It'll be really fast. He's like, what are you talking about? I'm like, listen, I am chasing failure, okay? Just get on the plane. He's like, they're not going to let me in. I go, just go with it, okay? Like, we don't know what is going to happen. Now, you can go home, and you're going to type in chasingfailure.com, and you're going to watch me try out for the Phoenix Suns. Spoiler alert, I failed. Can I tell you something? It was one of the greatest days of my life. Failure never felt any better. And here's why. You see, for the longest time, I was afraid to fail. And I wasn't just afraid to fail. I was afraid to do a lot of things. and something happened to me in Phoenix where I just wasn't scared anymore. And as I'm running around with the, I'm 6'3", and I became the shortest person in the room when usually I'm the tallest person in the room. It was real fun. And going from playing at 24-hour fitness to an NBA practice court isn't that big of a leap. Just kidding. It's humongous, okay? And I just kind of overcame some things in my life where it's just, I just don't think that failure has as big of a punch as we think it does. In fact, it made me better. It didn't make me bitter. And I learned more in that day than I did succeeding at anything else. And here's where I got the gusto to go. It's what Joshua is going through, and it's a leader. And what you have to understand about Joshua is he's taking over from Moses. For if you're not a Bible aficionado, Moses is a big deal. And when he dies, it's like, who's going to fill his shoes? And Joshua's that guy. Now, when God's talking to people, he usually doesn't have to repeat himself because, he's God. And so it's interesting that in this portion of Scripture, we see God tell Joshua to be strong and courageous 3 times. And on the last time, God takes it up to Nanny and he says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Here's what has the potential to change each and every life, each and every person watching online at every campus. When you know that God is with you, there's nothing that can stop you. But you really got to believe that he's with you. And here's proof that God is with each and every person. When a man named Jesus came to the planet, this is the name they gave him, Emmanuel, which means God is with us. For a long time in humanity, there was this overall feeling that God wasn't on our side, that God wasn't with humanity, and there was so much work for us to do to impress him and to get him on our side. And then when he sent Jesus, it changed everything. And so when you are a Christ follower, it's not God just saying, hey, be strong and courageous and you can do it. This is the verse that is in a lot of our bathrooms. It's on a lot of walls. Be strong and courageous. It's not a, hey, you can do it. He's telling Joshua and he's telling us to be strong and courageous because he's with us. In other words, God's saying, be brave, and I am my own insurance policy. You are not. Like, I'm going to back you up. That's why I'm telling you to be strong and courageous. I'm not telling you to get in the weight room. I'm not telling you to lift weights. I'm not telling you to be. I'm telling you to be strong in light of who's on your side. And here's what I love about this verse. Is that in the Bible, courage isn't suggested. It's not even optional. It's commanded. God's going, have I not commanded you? Be strong and be courageous. It's good news for some people in the room that might be afraid to step towards their dreams. It's good news for people in the room that might not know exactly what steps to take. But can we just not just trust the fact that God is on our side? Can we not just trust the fact that God is with us and to take a courageous step anyways? That no matter what it is that we face, no matter what that dream is, no matter who that person is that we want to be, that we can do that because we really believe that God is on our side and we really don't have an option to be afraid because of who is on our side. I believe that is how we can be brave. God, I thank you so much for each and every person under the sound of my voice And I pray for each and every dream that perhaps might be on the shelf. And Lord, I pray that we would dust that thing off and that we would be awoken to what you've called us to do. May we step bravely in the territory that you've called us to. May you awaken something in us. May we not be afraid to fail. And may we realize that because of who's with us, we have nothing to be afraid of in the first place. In Jesus' name I pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen.